sense of consciousness about how we treat old people in Canada. And it's about two old men, one of whom in the last month has vanished from the face of the earth, and the other of whom at 92, if he's well enough, hopefully will go back to Sweden, where he and his brother came from, to get better care in the declining years of the one surviving brother. It's 72 years since these two brothers, John Matson, now 92, and Karl, 87, set out to find their fortunes in Canada. And find their fortunes they did. But they finished up in this rest home. And as I say, one of them vanished a month ago. And I have a number of questions that I'm going to ask all of the community about how we look after old people in these circumstances under the long-term care program. A tricky subject indeed. Later in the program, we're going to look at the crippling newspaper strike in the city of Vancouver. That, of course, is the strike of Pacific Press. Pacific Press went out 24 hours ago, more or less, in another dispute, if you can believe it or not. And later in the program this morning, we're going to have Paddy Sherman, the publisher of the province, telling us the situation from management's point of view. But first, we're going to deal with the case of the missing man, Karl Matson, and his brother, John, 92 years of age. There are a number of disturbing aspects about the treatment and care of the Matson brothers, John 92 and Karl 86, which I feel must be raised in public at this time because of the fact that British Columbia has gone very quickly into something the public wants very badly. And that thing they want very badly is an effective long-term care program for old people, those who cannot look after themselves. And just to give you some basic facts, these two brothers came to this continent 72 years ago. And like many of these fine old Swedes, they were dedicated, industrious, hardworking men. They worked all through the Northwest. They were in Seattle, Tacoma, British Columbia, up in the North mining at one time. And like good old Swedes, they saved every nickel they had and they invested their money wisely. But they got to that age where they didn't quite know what to do with their money, if I can put it quite bluntly indeed. And for the last 25 years, the old boys lived in the Regent Hotel in Vancouver. It was quite satisfactory for them, but there were some accommodation problems there, and some person moved them to the Birch Rest Home, with the best of possible intentions, no doubt. But nobody seemed to find out, as I'm going to tell you in detail later, that the old boys were in possession of money and could have been much better cared for in their declining years. Another question I'm going to raise is that on the 1st of September, Karl disappeared, and it was some time before the police were notified. I think perhaps the best thing I can do is go back a little bit in history and tell you that I've seen old John now on two separate occasions. This is the rest home that he went to, two rest homes in West 15th in Vancouver. And I do my little stand-up piece here, and then we're going to visit John in the hospital. This is where the story really came to life for me. I went in to see old John in his room in the Birch Rest Home. There he was alone, 92, half blind, half deaf, with his brother's empty bed beside him, trying to sort out his somewhat pathetic possessions for his trip back to Sweden. Now, how did he get here in the first place? That's one thing that requires some looking into. John, and 92 as I say, and Karl, his 86-year-old brother, had been moved by some person trying to be helpful from the Regent Hotel, where they had lived for a quarter of a century or more, into the Birch Rest Home. What nobody knew or bothered to find out or was able to ascertain, that between them, they have assets in this country, because they saved every nickel they made as loggers through the years, of close on, if not more than, $300,000. They could have afforded to go to the best places, the most expensive places, to get really first-class care. But they finished up here. And then, around the 1st of September, Karl, who was given to wandering a little bit, but was not, as some people would try to tell you, a drinker in any way, shape, or form, vanished. When I say vanished, I mean as of this moment. More than a month later, Karl has disappeared off the face of the earth. And he was not reported missing until 6 or 7 days after he failed to return to this rest home. Now, Mr. Wallace, the operator of the home, admits that to me. Says in justification, the man had wandered at some other times. But in my view, there is no justification for not telling the police forthwith when an old man doesn't come back for his bed check. Now, scabies. That appeared in this establishment. You can't blame Mr. Wallace for the introduction of scabies. Somebody could have brought it in. The fact remains there have been 4 or 5 cases of scabies in this establishment. It's a most humiliating, degrading illness caused by little mites. Mr. Wallace assures me that he has followed the instructions of the health department in boiling the clothes, and the underclothes too, but not your own clothing in the cupboard. And of course, once you get scabies, they're damn difficult to get rid of. And here's old John when I see him yesterday, 92, half blind, half deaf, itching all over the blinking place. And he has now been moved to St. Paul's Hospital. Just by happenstance, I can tell you in the course of my checking out the circumstances that Mr. Wallace has been ordered to appear about November the 15th in front of the provincial government's community care licensing board to show cause why his licenses to operate these two homes, the Birch and the Maple, should not be removed. But now let's go down to St. Paul's and see how old John's settling in before he goes back to Sweden. John, when did you come to Canada? When did you come to the States?
1896.
1896? Yeah. And then you came to British Columbia in the 1900s?
Something like that, yes.
In fact, you've been in Vancouver 72 years, you were telling me.
72 years. No, I've been in, that's including what I was in the States, no, 72 years since I left Sweden.
72 years since you left Sweden. And how long did you and Karl live in the Regent Hotel in Vancouver? How many years do you think?
Ever since I quit work, but 29 years I stayed there, I think.
29 or 30 years. Why did you leave the Regent, John? Was it just, were you getting too old?
Yeah, I'm getting too old, I guess.
And so you went into the rest home, eh?
Yes.
Tell me, you're 90, how old? How old are you?
92 years old.
How old is Karl?
He's 5 years younger.
So that makes him 87, doesn't it?
Yeah.
86, 87.
Yeah.
What happened to Karl?
Well, he was lost. I got a good idea what happened to him, but I can't prove anything like that, you know.
But how long is it since he didn't come back to the rest home? He went out one day and he didn't come back, right?
Yeah, he went out. He was going into Vancouver to buy a few things, you know.
And he never came back?
Never came back. I told you, well, he was in, you know, almost every day or a day or so, you know. I told him not to go all alone when he told him dangerous, but he wanted to go in. And
so it's about long since you've seen him, about a month?
Oh, yes, must be.
When did he disappear?
Well, that's what I can't remember now.
1st of September, you told me.
September, October.
September the 1st,
yeah,
it was.
Yeah, it might have been September.
And how do you like being in here all nice and clean and shiny? Hmm?
Like being here?
Being in here in St. Paul's.
Well, I don't like to stay in the hospital if I don't have to, naturally.
But you're only going to stay a few days to get kind of tidied up, eh?
Well, I got a itch, you see. They told me, they gave me a hot bed and put some
stuff on you.
Stuff on it, you see.
Tell
they
me.
Told me about a day or two, they told me to stay here.
John, what do you want to do? Do you want to go back to Sweden with to your family?
Well, this is a question that sometimes I think I'm right, or sometimes I think I didn't. It's no good. I don't know.
You don't know what to do.
I don't know what to do, but I went so far now. I guess I can't back out now.
Oh no! But the fact is, though, that yeah, you were alone in that place with Karl gone, and you didn't have a relative in the world here, did you?
No, I didn't know. And all my friends died out too. You know, I got no friends or anything. Uh-huh. They all died. You see. Passed out people that wasn't.
John, I'm glad to see you look a lot better today than you did yesterday, I'll tell you that. And then you can see how you feel, and Gourley and Kiki, they'll give you good advice on what you should do from here on. Look after yourself, eh?
Yeah.
Okay?
Well, okay.
You were a logger, weren't you?
Yes.
A faller?
Faller, yeah.
And you saved every penny you had, didn't you?
I mean, kind of careful, I didn't. Kind of careful, you know, I didn't.
Didn't waste any money?
I didn't do any bad drinking or anything like that.
Oh, by the way, did Karl wasn't a drinker, was he?
No.
Never?
Never.
But he was a wee bit absent-minded towards the end, wasn't he? Towards the time he disappeared.
Yeah, I kind of started to be absent-minded, yeah.
Absent-minded. Well, don't know where he is now, but maybe he'll turn up, eh?
No, right. So I'm absolutely sure of that. Something happened to him, if he could be, was alive, I would hear about that long time ago.
He was your last friend in Canada, wasn't
he? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Was he a logger too?
Yes.
Best of luck, John. Best of luck.
Yes.
You'll notice that in John's room in St. Paul's, I'm wearing the rubber gloves and the white vest to prevent any spread of the scabies. But he was in so much better shape once he'd got out of the rest home, taken out of there and put into St. Paul's, where he's going to be stabilized and cleaned up and his plans made for the future. And with me this morning, I've got Kiki Terlongou, who is the granddaughter of John's sister. That makes you a kind of grandniece of John himself.
It must be, yes.
And also in Vancouver with Kiki is her mother, who is in fact John's niece. And we'll discuss this more in a minute or two. Kiki Terlongou, as I was explaining, your grandmother was John's sister.
Yes,
right.
That's true.
Well, it's a bit late to welcome you to Canada in these circumstances, but just broadly speaking, how would you compare the treatment of an old man like your granduncle, John, and Karl, God knows where he is, compared to how it would be in Sweden?
You know, you can't compare it at all. In Sweden, John should have been in a nice, clean resting home with nurses in white uniform, everything cleaned up. They shouldn't have any stairs that they could fall over and broken their legs. There wouldn't be any scabies. It should be completely clean. And it would be nice. They should have music, TV. They could have their parties, going dancing, inviting friends and guests there. And they should really liked it.
And the other very important thing is that they would not be, I presume, be allowed to wander away.
No.
Now, we have, we don't think it's all exactly like this, but when were the old boys, I mean, Canadian, we're only beginning in this business. Mm-hmm. We just really began it, and we're maybe 25, 50 years behind Sweden, which is why I'm glad that we got in touch with each other so we could demonstrate the story on the air. But tell me, when were the old boys last in Sweden?
They were in Sweden 1953, 25 years ago, and for a visit.
For a visit. And they were in good shape and good health then.
Oh, yeah, they were.
And did the family keep in touch with John and Karl?
Oh, yes. We were writing letters to each other.
When did you begin to get worried about them?
It started 1 year ago because suddenly the letters stopped and we didn't hear from them. And we couldn't keep in contact. And we know that something was happening. Mm-hmm. Maybe they were getting old. We know that John couldn't see to write letters. So we start to wonder what's happening with them. Mm-hmm.
And that was the time you phoned the Regent Hotel?
Yes.
Tell me about that.
We phoned the Regent Hotel, and we know they have been living there for about 25, 30 years. And they told us that they moved out from there, and they couldn't give us their address. They didn't know where they was.
So there you were, stuck again.
Yes,
they had just vanished, and you began to get considerably worried at that particular time.
Really.
Fortunately, you did get, somebody did write you a letter, didn't they?
Yes, it was a social worker that was writing us a letter.
And then what did you do after that?
We was keeping in contact with this woman. We were phoning her up, and she told that it would be the best way if we could come over here to Vancouver and help Mr. John, because his brother was missing.
Mm-hmm. Now, the boys, the old men, as I said on the program this morning, they were just a little bit beyond in knowing what to do because they weren't poor, were they?
No, they were not poor at all. They could have paid for themselves to be in a better place.
So one of the things we're wondering about is how, in the first instance, when they were moved from the Regent Hotel, somebody didn't have enough common sense to find out that they had considerable assets and could have paid whatever was necessary to have them properly looked after with nurses and white uniforms and activities and all the rest of it.
That's true.
Now, when you came to Vancouver, how long ago?
I came here 1 week ago.
1 week ago.
Yeah.
I got in touch with you just a couple of days ago. And then you went, and when you saw John first in the rest home, what did he tell you? Was your mother able to communicate with him in Swedish?
Oh, yes, in the old Swedish dialect. Mm-hmm. He speaks in dialect of Swedish, not normal Swedish as we are speaking now. So I speak English with him.
You speak English? Because you can't speak the old Swedish
dialect.
No,
I can't.
Now, I'll tell you what, they came, I got a little confused with John about when he actually came. You know precisely, don't you? It was 1906, I think.
Yes, it was.
They didn't come straight to Vancouver.
No, he went to the States first. I think he was living in Seattle for a while. And also I knew he's been up in Alaska. Mm-hmm. He was hunting up there and gold mining.
And then they finished up as loggers in British Columbia.
Yes.
Now, what were you told when you arrived about your missing the other brother, Karl?
Yeah, John told us that he has gone out the 1st of September and he hadn't returned and he was sure that someone has killed him. That was what he thought.
Well, nobody knows him.
Nobody knows for sure where he is.
But Mr. Wallace admitted to me that, yes, the man did disappear on the 1st of September, that somebody had told him, I'm not quite sure who it was, that he wasn't too worried because he believed he was a drinker. That is not correct, is it?
No, it's not correct, not at all.
In fact, old John told me yesterday that sometime that they would get a bottle of whiskey or whatever for New Year and have the same bottle for the next New Year. Now, John has a fair amount of assets, does he not?
Yes, he has.
And Karl has a similar chunk of money.
Mm-hmm.
Now that Karl is missing, you saw the public trustee, did you not?
Yes, I did.
And what's he going to do about looking after Karl's affairs?
He's going to take care of everything there now.
He's going to be the curator of Karl's money, because all his stocks and bonds are in, and his bank account, stocks and bonds are in a safety deposit box,
yes,
as I recall.
It is.
What about the scabies? That must really have upset you.
Oh, it's so terrible, so it's hard to talk about it. You know, scabies in a resting home?
Well,
I never heard about it before.
4 or 5 people in that rest home have contracted scabies. And I've spoken to the medical health officer about it, and all they do at the moment is that they give the operator a list of instructions to follow.
Yeah.
And hopefully that's followed up. And in fact, when I said about boiling the clothes, I meant boiling the bed clothes.
No.
But the personal clothes in the cupboard, you're going to have to leave all that stuff here.
We have to leave everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, we are just going to buy him new clothes.
And not
everything.
Touch it.
No.
Now, what about old John? Do you think you would like to take him back to Sweden?
Yeah, if he can manage, we will take him back. It's up to him. If he really wants to go back to Sweden, we will take him. Or if he wants to stay here, we will find him a nice place.
Yeah, but this time we'll find him a nice place.
Yeah, I hope so.
Where, if necessary, he can pay the extra for the room differential or whatever.
Yeah,
he can do that. And the proper care.
Yeah.
Well, he was in remarkably good spirits yesterday in St. Paul's. Was it you who took him out of the rest home and took him to St. Paul's?
I did. Yes.
Well, you know, we were lucky getting him into St. Paul's. I think we should say that, because he's not acutely ill.
No.
And under our rigid hospital insurance regulations, as such, he was not really entitled. So I will give St. Paul's a little pat in the back for taking him, because there's nowhere else you can put him in isolation to have him cleaned up.
We had nowhere at all to put him, no other places at all.
So things look a little better now. You'll make a decision as to whether or not you're going to take him back.
Yes, we are.
According to what he wants to do. The public trustee will look after Carl's money until Carl is... Oh, just show me before I go. Do we have a picture of Carl? We do, don't we? Let me see that picture, the group picture, and we'll... Just in case, which one is Carl?
Carl is the one to the right.
Top right-hand side of the screen. And is that John to his left?
Yes, it is.
And in front... is another brother.
It's another brother.
Another brother. That picture must have been taken in 1953 then, eh?
No, I think it was taken late. No, it must have been 1953.
1953.
Yes.
And just for nostalgia, we have another picture of John 6 years after he came to North America. Can I see that picture, please? And there he is.
It's a handsome boy.
A handsome boy. And it's really a shame to think of him lying and with scabies in a rest home, and you having to come from Sweden virtually to rescue him from the Canadian social system, is it not?
Mm-hmm, that's true.
Going to talk a little bit more about this case with Kiki Terlongou, and myself for that matter. I am able to tell you that Isabel Kimmett, who is in charge of the entire long-term care program in British Columbia, is going to be on the program with me on Monday morning to discuss perhaps not this particular case in detail, because there are delicate aspects to it of which I am sure you're aware, but to discuss a widespread problem in British Columbia on the standards of long-term care. There are many good long-term care homes, I am sure. I'm told that about 90% of the various rest homes, hospitals, and whatnot follow through on the required standard by the regulations. That does not mean, however, that the inmates, wrong word, that the patients of these homes get the kind of care they should get for the money that is being expended. And just a couple of basic facts I want to stress on this particular case. One, let me ask you, Kiki,
yes?
You know how crassly material North Americans happen to be, but I want to make the point that John and Carl were, in their own right, quite wealthy by ordinary standards.
Yes, they were.
How much money does John have, do you think?
Oh, I think about 150,000.
And that's under control. Very
that's
helpful
under
bank
control.
Manager, I
yes,
understand.
Yes, it is.
The bank manager was very helpful to
they
you.
They were very helpful, and they were treating him very, very nicely.
Even though when he was going in, he didn't look all that prosperous,
no,
did he?
No, he didn't. He was looking like a beggar.
Yeah, looking like a beggar. In fact, that old suit he had on in the rest home, he must have had for many years.
Maybe for 25 years.
And he's lost at least 25 pounds since he got that suit.
Mm-hmm.
So, about 150,000. Carl, about the same, maybe?
A bit more.
Maybe a bit more.
Yes.
They invested, didn't they?
They'd invested it, yes.
And Carl's, John's affairs are now being handled by the bank manager, and you'll be in a position with John's authority to know precisely what he has.
Yes.
Now, Carl, nobody yet knows. You have a good idea because you've got his bank accounts.
Yes.
And it'll be up to my friend Clinton Foote, the public trustee,
that's true,
acting as curator for Carl's money to make sure it is properly secured and eventually handled in the proper manner. Yeah. Isn't that right?
That's right.
The other thing that I want to mention is, Isabel Kimmett's coming, is the police. And one must be practical about these things, Kiki. When old men disappear and wander away, and somebody tells them they're drunks, I don't think the police get overly anxious about the old boys.
No.
They just wait until they turn up, if they turn up. But don't you feel, as I do, that had, you know, his picture been circulated,
yes,
had the alarm been raised much earlier, perhaps the second day or even the third day, or an advert in the paper, has anybody seen this old man, or his picture up on television, has anybody seen this old man, that he might have been found in time? It's really very disturbing indeed. I invited, by the way, I should tell you, I invited Mr. Wallace to appear on the television with me. We had a lengthy conversation. He chose not to appear with me. And I said to him very bluntly indeed, why did you not report Carl missing for 6 or 7 days? And he said, oh, and I'm being fair to Wallace in this respect, he said he had wandered away on other occasions, but he'd always come back. And I said to him, well, you should certainly have reported him missing to the police and put the responsibility on their shoulders, at least the first morning he wasn't back in his bed. As I pointed out to you, I've discovered in the course of my investigation that Mr. Wallace is the licensee for two homes, the Birch Home and the Maple Home. And he is to appear to show cause why his licenses should not be removed around about November the 15th. Well, Kiki, you've got quite a few things to do today too, haven't you?
Oh, yes. We have to buy new clothes for Jan.
Right.
Everything new and clean.
You guessed the sizes.
Yeah, I guess it.
Maybe you should, I guessed a size 15 and maybe a size 36 waist.
I think I can always change the clothes if they doesn't fit.
You can change the clothes if they don't fit. Maybe you should get one of the nurses there to estimate his size or take his measurements.
Yeah, I can do
not
that
too. Not a bad
too.
Idea, is it?
I can
and
do that too.
And then you've got to make the decision. Oh, you've got to get a doctor to tell you whether or not he's fit to travel.
Yeah, we will do that today too.
He's not sick as such.
No, he's not sick, he's just old.
Old and he's got this...
Old and tired.
Damnable scabies infection.
Yeah, but that's the worst thing.
A couple of days may well put that under control.
Yeah, I hope so.
And then I'm sure he'll be in much better shape today or tomorrow to help, for you to help him to decide what he's going to do.
Yeah. Hmm?
Well, I'm sorry things you found in Canada weren't quite the way I suspect you would find them in Sweden. Oh, and there was another very helpful group of people that you wanted to mention.
In the passport
Tell
office.
Tell me about that.
Yeah, I was going there with all the papers of Jan. I didn't have him with me. And I got a passport for him. Mm-hmm. And he was the oldest man that I ever had been written a passport for. And they were really grateful. And I didn't have his signature on the photos, but they fixed it for me.
They fixed it for you?
Yes, they
did. So you got the passport in a matter of moments, more or less.
I will pick it up on Friday,
and
tomorrow.
If he's well enough to go, and if you decide together he should go, you'll go down to Seattle and fly?
To Copenhagen, and from Copenhagen to Stockholm.
To Stockholm.
Yes.
And would you then, would you take him to the family place?
First, we have to keep him in the family place for 1 month before he can get to a retire home or something, because he's a Canadian member.
Oh, he'd have to be there a month.
Yeah.
But born in Sweden, you wouldn't anticipate any trouble.
No.
Describe the kind of place he would go into in Sweden.
Yeah, we will put him in a resting home where he was born, in the city of Mura.
Mura?
Yes. And there they are speaking that dialect that he can understand. And there are other old people in his age there. Maybe he has some friends. And he has nieces and grandnieces over there. And we can all take care of him, to visit him. And he will have a clean place, good meal, good clothes.
When he was in this rest home after he left the Regent, did he get out at all? Did he go to the bank at all? Or was it not until you came that he went out?
He never went out because he's nearly blind. It was his brother who went out.
And 10 steps up the front too.
Yes.
He couldn't possibly have negotiated the 10 steps out into the garden around the rest home, could he?
He couldn't went out himself.
Well, our apologies
for
what happened to John and our sadness about what, God knows what happened to Karl, eh?
Yeah, nobody knows.
Nobody
so
knows.
So far.
Well, I might, yes, I'll go to the phones on this, but I don't want to discuss any particular aspects. But in view of the fact I'm interviewing Isabel Kimmett on Monday, those of you with experience about rest homes and private hospitals, which you find good or bad, because I'm not damning them all. I don't want to give panic in the streets to everybody who's got a relative in some kind of long-term care. But I think in our society, it's quite essential that we pinpoint the areas of concern. Hello. Nobody there, Linda. Are you there? One. Hello there. What do you want to talk about? I don't want you to libel anybody. I don't want to hear that on the air.
30 seconds.
No, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to do anything but like that. Yeah. How long ago is that?
15, Jack.
Just tell me they were nice old guys. Hold on. Don't go away. Don't tell me. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes.
That's me?
That's you.
Yeah, I'm just watching this thing this morning, it just chokes me right up. And I'm not going to get into any areas that, I'm not going to talk about any hospitals or anything. I just want to offer my help if I can, if they need any transportation or want to any assistance in any way, I'd certainly like to volunteer if I could.
Well, that's very nice of you, but I think Kiki and her mother are totally copacetic and know their way around well. But you do appreciate it, don't you, Kiki?
Oh, yes, very much.
Thank you very much for your call. Go ahead, please. Hello.
Yes, sir. Have you checked any of the Salvation Army homes throughout Vancouver, Burnaby, New Westminster? He could have wandered quite a distance.
You mean that Karl might be in one?
Well, yes.
Oh, no. The Salvation Army, one must give them credit. If they find a nameless old man who's lost his memory, they would immediately get in touch with the city police or the RCMP. As I say, they don't go out rushing looking for these old people, unfortunately, because they can't, I don't suppose. But they're on a master index, and they would come up on the computer. No, the Salvation Army would not keep somebody in their place without double-checking their identity. Of that, I'm quite sure. Go ahead, please.
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
That's you.
Well, I work in a hospital, and I've seen a couple of cases where people have come in, and one woman, she had maggots growing in her legs and open wounds, and she was left in bed for several days. And when we saw her, she came in the hospital, she had to have severe surgery to her legs.
Now, she came in, she was brought into a private hospital in this condition.
No, she was brought into one of the larger hospitals in
You mean a private hospital or a general hospital?
A general hospital in that condition.
Oh, yes, you mean because of that, but you can't necessarily blame the operator for like that. For instance, about Wallace's place, he didn't introduce the scabies. That would be brought in by somebody in that condition. What we must assure, though, is that where the condition appears in a rest home, that the health authorities take the steps. I would not leave it to the owner or operator alone to take the step. Now, presumably that woman was allowed to stay in the hospital on BCHIS and be cleaned up. Was she?
No, she was brought into the hospital from a nursing
home. Oh, how long had she been in the nursing home?
She was in a nursing home for at least like a year or so. She was old and her family couldn't take care of her.
You're suggesting that...
lack of care there.
You're suggesting that it was the conditions in this nursing home which caused the maggot-infested wound on the leg.
Right, there was no care properly given in some reports about nursing homes.
Did anybody take any action on it?
No, they didn't.
Do you want to tell Linda off the air, please? Linda, I'll pick up your call. And you tell... When was this, by the way?
This was in the last month.
In the last month. Well, I must have your phone number, which I shall keep confidential. If you give me the information, mm-hmm. I will check out the specific case with Isabel Kimmett on Monday morning. Linda, will you take three away? Don't go away now. Hold on. Go ahead, please.
Yes, well, Jack, I remember the two boys because I've worked, and in fact, they lived opposite my room when I lived in the hotel and worked there.
In the old Regent?
Yes.
Where is the old Regent again?
Pardon?
Where is it?
Yeah, the Regent Hotel, 160 East Hastings.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And well, then, they lived opposite me, and the only time we seen the boys was but three times during the day. And the last time would be 11 o'clock at evening when they came downstairs to watch the TV, to watch the old news, and that was it. And they'd go shopping to the Save-On Meat Market, you know, down on Hastings Street there, and that would be once about every third day.
What year was that?
I mean, they never mingled with anybody. They just sat by themselves all the time.
What year was that?
Well, I quit there in 1975 of August.
Were they bright?
Yes. Oh, yes. Yeah, both of them were. And while the John, the little thinner one, he was short and thinner than his brother Carl was taller.
Did you recognize John this morning?
Pardon?
Did you recognize John?
Oh, yes, yes. But only he was... he was small and he was his vision wasn't very good.
No, he's really half blind and half deaf.
Yeah, well, he had very thick glasses then, and, he wasn't wearing a hearing aid at that time.
He wasn't wearing one today either, was he?
No.
No, I never noticed, no.
Anyway, I'm glad to tell you that John's in very good hands now in St. Paul's.
Oh, so am I.
And his niece and his niece's daughter are here looking after affairs.
Great.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Thank you. That's nice to hear, isn't it?
Very nice.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Mr. Webster.
Good morning.
I have some light to shed on the whole subject regarding the Community Care Facilities Licensing Act by the provincial government.
Yeah?
Now, they brought in these regulations last year and very quickly discovered that the regulations were unenforceable, since if they were enforced, a good percentage of the homes in the Lower Mainland and B.C. would be closed down because they couldn't comply.
In other words, you're suggesting that the regulations are great on paper but cannot be complied with because of the standard of many of the homes? Are you talking about personal care homes?
Yes, sir.
Not about private hospitals?
No.
All right, what are the standards to which you say these regulations are phony and cannot be applied?
I'm sorry?
What are the particular things they can't meet?
Oh, a very large number of them regarding staircases, elevators, fire equipment. That's a big bone of contention at this moment, as far as plus licensing, etc. The whole picture.
And don't forget staffing. Don't forget staffing.
Yes, definitely. The whole thing.
Did you see anybody in a white uniform in that rest home?
No.
Well, I must tell you this. Don't go away, Carl. I was out in one of our most expensive public old folks' homes out at the University of British Columbia. And would you believe the nurses are not required to wear uniforms? Mm-hmm. They wear jeans and sweaters. And this is to be informal, but it's so informal that the poor old dears in their 80s and 90s don't know who's a nurse and who's a patient.
That's true.
We need the formal treatment with white uniforms so that they have a feeling of security because of that.
Yeah.
Look, I'm interested. Any other points? You say that a number of them cannot comply.
Oh, very definitely, sir.
Well, in this one yesterday, there were 10 steps up the front, which make it quite impossible for somebody like John to negotiate if he were well enough to go out. Isn't that right?
It's impossible.
But again, I make some slight apology for the fact that we are backward in this area and that the government promised everybody long-term care on the 1st of January, I think it was, and so by necessity, they have registered or licensed some of these places, which in my humble opinion, should not be licensed. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Very helpful call.
Bye now.
Go ahead, please.
Hang in there while I turn the TV down a minute.
Oh, I can't hang in while you turn the TV down. I'll come back to you. Is it time for a break? Hello. It's time for a break. Are you there on 7? Okay, you're next up. We'd like to put down the phone and push the button again. Go ahead, please, ma'am.
Hello. I was thinking of this in another aspect almost, and that goes into mental institutions and some of the old folks who have been in mental institutions for years and years, and not because they are mentally disabled in any way, just because they are old and there's no other place.
Ma'am, I would tell you that compared to some of the rest homes I've seen, some of which are used in effect as halfway houses, I would rather see them, and I may be old-fashioned and wrong in this, in a clinically clean institution with constant supervision than in a rest home of doubtful caliber.
Yes.
I really do not believe that hashed together halfway houses are the answer for anyone, to be quite honest, unless they're really copacetic compos mentis and able to look after themselves. But that's just my opinion. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yes.
It upsets me to hear this case, but we have a very fine Swedish rest home right here in Vancouver.
I know we have a very fine Swedish rest home in Vancouver, and if anyone had taken the trouble to find out the true circumstances of these old men, with their assets or without their assets, I am confident they would have finished up in the Swedish rest home.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure of that, too.
And matter of fact, we'll be, in case John really doesn't want to go, we'll be giving them a call today to see what they can offer, if anything, or an equally good place.
Yeah.
For John's last few years, eh?
Yes.
Do you know the Swedish rest home well?
Well.
It has an excellent reputation.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
I think it's one of the finest in the city.
Is that still in North Van, or is it in?
It's located up near Burnaby Mountain.
Up near Burnaby? Oh, it's a new home now, isn't it?
Mm. It used to be on the North Shore.
I'm much obliged. Yes, I remember it when it was on the North Shore. Where are you speaking from?
Hello?
Where are you speaking from?
From Barrier.
Oh, Barrier, up beyond Kamloops.
Right.
Yes, yes.
Your suggestion about putting a photo on the news or something like that is excellent one, but can we have that be done?
Yes, it cannot always be done, but I could have written a story about old Karl Matson if anybody had phoned me to saying a wealthy old man has wandered away, and if you could put, I'm not suggesting this is necessarily the right way to do it, but if you can put a news peg on a missing man or, of course, a missing child or a missing woman, the media, by and large, will cooperate. For that matter, you could buy time in the newspapers.
Well, I...
But in these circumstances, 86, 87, 92, I think we've got enough compassion in the media to do something about it. We certainly should, in my opinion.
Well...
And I would, I'll tell you.
Well, what can anybody do to get this into effect?
Well, forget the media aspect. Of much more important aspect is the fact that men who are absent-minded or women who are absent-minded must not be allowed to wander away. They must be given some supervision. Surely that's got to be the better answer. How's the weather in Barrier?
Oh, it's very good.
Not snowing yet?
No, not yet.
Won't be long. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I must say that I had...
And you're speaking from where?
Pardon?
Where are you speaking from?
Victoria.
Victoria, yeah.
Yes. My dad has spent the last 2 years in a lovely rest home, Ebenezer Home in Abbotsford. That's a really nice...
There are many nice rest homes, ma'am, but it's unfortunate that poor old John and Carol...
He was well cared for, and they had a chair, and he didn't...
Ma'am, I've said that, and I believe it, but it's the other ones that it's my function to talk about.
Yes.
But not damn them all. Not worry everybody about the care being given to their elderly relatives. Go ahead, please.
Is that me?
That's you.
Oh, well, I was calling because I was, matter of fact, thinking of this topic that you're discussing this morning. I used to take care of youngsters, And my children now are away at college, and I'm 49, and my husband's 52, and we have a lovely home in Richmond.
In other words, you'd like to look after one or two old people.
Yes, and I'm cooking for my husband, and I...
Well, let me tell you briefly that I believe, is perfectly possible under the system, and I will discuss that aspect. In fact, you can talk to Isabel Kimmett Monday morning on the program.
Oh, good.
She's the director and the boss of the entire long-term care program, and a very cooperative person.
Well, but they asked me if I'm licensed, and I said, well, come out because I have...
We'll talk. Don't bog me down on that now. I'll talk to Isabel about that Monday, if you remind me. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Webster.
Yes.
We're continually hearing about old people going missing from rest homes. Now, I'm wondering why our regulations do not require these rest homes to have a current photograph of their patients. It's pretty hard to give the police or anyone else.
All they've got to do is buy one of these instant cameras, like a one-step.
Right.
Or the Kodak equivalent, to give them equal time, and they'd have a current photograph of each patient. I think it's an excellent idea, and I recommend it to all operators of private homes and hospitals, so that when old Karl doesn't show up, the very next morning they go down to the police department and say, he's gone, here is his picture.
How about pushing the provincial government on it?
Well, it's not the kind of thing they'll jump for, but I'll push Isabel Kimmett on it. Better still, I'll push the private rest home operators association on it.
Right.
Because they've got to watch their image, you know, and very much so. I've done many programs over the years on unsatisfactory conditions, and I'm convinced things have improved, but they haven't improved enough. Okay, boy. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Webster, you're a proponent of uniforms and clean institutions?
You're damn right I am.
Well, I think that perhaps when you're talking of uniforms and clean institutions, you should check out Valley View.
Now, there you go again. Again, a different topic. Valley View, I've had no complaints about for a long while. In fact, I've always regarded it as one of the best old folks' homes in the country.
Well, Valley
I hope
View,
I'm still right.
Valley View does have scabies, badly.
Well, presumably in a provincial institution, they take all possible steps to eliminate it. Don't tell me otherwise.
Not really. They eliminate
Ma'am, I'll put it on my list. Linda, put it on the list. Makes me itchy even to talk about it. Go ahead, please. Where are you?
Yeah, me.
That's you.
Oh, first of all, ska jag säga välkommen, Kiki, till Vancouver.
I can't hear you.
Again, a little louder, please. Go on, in Swedish again.
Ja, välkommen till Vancouver, Kiki.
Tack ska du ha.
Ja, och så får jag säga något till Sverige om svenska.
Ja, gör det.
Så han är, vi har ett väldigt bra resthom här.
Ja.
Och om man inte kommer in på det så har Normenia i Westminster och så finns det danska resthomet och så.
Jaha.
Så... There are all the possibilities here too, you know, but I go home once in a while to Sweden and I have the feeling that the service here of some of those homes are comparable.
Då ska vi försöka få in honom på det svenska hemmet om han inte vill följa med oss hem till Sverige.
Yeah, that would be the best thing, Kiki.
Yeah.
Is he talking about the Swedish-Danish rest home in New Westminster?
Yes.
No, a Swedish rest home, but even the Norwegian in Westminster have one.
Scandinavian.
Thank you very much indeed.
Yeah, tack så mycket.
Tack.
Tack, what? What does that
Thank
mean?
Thank you. Thank you.
Say it again.
Tack.
Tack så mycket.
Tack så mycket.
Tack så mycket. And thank you very much, Kiki. Next, we're going to do a different story. I hope all goes well with you. You'll keep in touch with me. I'm sure they'll be well looked after in St. Paul's Hospital. They'll keep him there to stabilize him. And you'll make the decision with John about his future.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Paddy Sherman, publisher of The Province. The New York strike has just ended. How long did it last?
Best part of 3 months, Jack. I think 14 weeks.
14 weeks. Yeah. How many unions did that involve?
Well, there are roughly the same unions involved there as here, but it was, again, basically the one-issue strike with the pressmen.
You called it feather bedding, they call it manning.
Well,
isn't that
right?
And what it means, and I don't want to hammer this too much, but it's hard to believe in 1978, They mean they want men standing around doing nothing forever.
In essence, that does apply in certain cases.
How long will this strike last?
I have no idea, Jack. We're happy to go back today and start negotiating on this fundamental point. Any minute.
Is the Pressman's Union the toughest issue involved, or does this Manning become involved, say, in the ITU?
No. The only other place it's involved is in the mailing room.
The pressmen in the mailing room, they're traditionally side by side, you might say, in the negotiation.
That's right.
Now, how about the ITU and technological change? Did you not make some considerable progress in that?
We went through all that, and we settled it rationally, and there are no problems arising from it. Now, we guaranteed printers, again, jobs for life. And
when was the last strike?
The last strike we took was against the AIB a couple of years ago.
Well, that was the AIB strike. That didn't last so long, did it?
No, that was quite brief.
When was the last long strike when they brought out the Express? That's about 4 years ago.
That was in 1970.
1970, that long ago. Right. Are you concerned by the fact that they're going to bring out the Express very shortly?
I'm concerned primarily that it may siphon off their interests and energy of some key guild members that might be more usefully employed trying to get negotiations back on track. They'll get so carried away with what they're doing, very understandably, that they won't be exerting the sorts of pressures that you might expect them to in the circumstances.
Is there not a danger or a risk to you that if this paper gets off the ground, that it could become another Toronto Sun, which was slightly different set of circumstances after the telly went out of biz? The Toronto Sun has suddenly appeared, mind you, it's mostly full of columns and agency stuff, but it is a viable newspaper, isn't it?
Well, no, the circumstances are quite different, Jack. The record of strike papers generally is that the minute the strike is over, they are voluntarily out of business. There are some very talented people on the staffs of both papers. They'll enjoy working for this. It'll take their minds off other things, but they know very well they can do a much better job back with the original papers, I heard Alex Young say just that on radio this morning.
Yeah, he's going to be the managing editor of the newspaper. Right. Now, just to recap, before I go to the telephones, Linda, if there are any calls on the topic, just to recap, you were in the middle of negotiations with all the unions,
right,
one way and another, right, partly joint, partly separate,
right,
and the pressman just said, as long as you people are making the proposition of a $5,000 bonus and cutting the Manning by attrition, we won't talk to you. Withdraw that offer or we go out.
You've got it right in a nutshell, Jack.
No, I'm a reporter speaking to you as a reporter, even
right,
if you are now a publisher. That is an accurate report.
Exactly.
Pretty hard to take, isn't it?
It's not a rational behavior. It's an emotional behavior, and I hope some reason will come into the discussion fairly soon.
But this union attitude surely must reflect the political attitude that you carry as the publishers of a newspaper, which over the years has made much money, and now you have the advantages of change to cut your costs, that you bear the responsibility to keep that union membership, this is their attitude, at their chosen level, regardless of previous Manning policies, regardless of the current Manning policies.
Well,
see what I mean?
Not exactly, but what you're saying basically is they want to stay at their present levels.
They want you to carry the total responsibility for their employment regardless of your problems.
For the ongoing health of the union as opposed to the ongoing health of the members.
Well, why do the members go for it if it's so patently stupid?
Well, Jack, you'd really better ask them, but when you have a closed shop union where people that are not hired directly by the company, the union has far more say in these things than most people would credit.
We're hoping that Clark Davey, the new publisher of The Sun, might join us for a few minutes.
Good.
But I think I've got time, Fred, to take a couple of calls. Go ahead, please, to Sherman and Webster.
Yeah, I want to talk to Mr. Sherman. I was wondering, hello?
Yes, speak up.
I was wondering, what if I took the $5,000, what do I have to give up? It seems to me when he said that at first, that they would give up something. What do they give up?
Give up restrictive practices in the way we use manpower in the press room. We would wind up at first, even if we changed quite considerably the way we operated the presses, we would still have the same number of pressmen we have now until attrition started to work.
Well, there are two things there. You want to change the manner of manning on the presses right now, everybody would keep their job and get a $5,000 bonus for accepting this. Doesn't that mean that a number of men would be doing nothing on the payroll?
That's something we would have to live with until attrition started to work. And we have told the unions we are very open to discuss how this would take effect, when it would take effect, how it would be phased in. We want to have a genuine negotiation.
Question, do you have an aging pressman staff? Are they aging? Are you close to, say, a particularly big wipeout by retirement or attrition?
I couldn't give you statistics.
I mean, if all the
that.
Men were 60, but sure.
No, we have a lot of younger members, too.
You have a lot of younger men,
yes,
too.
Yes.
Does that answer your question, caller?
Yeah, there's one, and there's the other thing is, wouldn't it be nice if they picked up on your program and did their negotiations there? I bet you'd settle a lot of strikes in a hurry.
Nonsense, schmonsense. But especially when a newspaper strike is on, it's certainly our duty to cover both sides. And I hope we'll be contacting the pressman today anyway to come on the program, I can assure you. And the Guild, and the Joint Council. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd like to ask Mr. Sherman if it is not true that with the Newspaper Guild, he very blithely passed over a few members he said they would like to take out of the Guild into non-union. Is it not true that it is very close to 50% of the Guild membership?
What's the percentage of the Guild membership?
We are talking about a handful, something between a dozen and 20. I heard Mr. Needham today use a figure of perhaps 200, which is rubbish.
Wrong. Next, Clark Davey, the new publisher of the Vancouver Sun, is going to join us.
Well, Jack, you right?
Hold on.
In fact, when I was here last...
Oh, I'm talking about this.
No, I'm... Well, all right.
You're just a little shiny.
Am I? Oh, well, that's... Yeah.
I think you're beautiful. I'll never get his name spelled right. C-L-A-R-K-D-A-V-E-Y.
Hey,
Jack,
right the first
we can
time.
Go past, apparently we can go past 10:30 if you want to.
Yes, I want to.
He wants to go past 10:30.
How far can I go past 10:30?
He wants to go past 10:30.
Yes.
Oh.
Yes. How far can I go?
No E.
Jack, I've got to leave at 10:30. I can leave you with Clark.
You can leave me with Clark.
Sure.
You going back?
Yeah.
I can ride with you, or you want to go back ahead of me?
Couldn't you both stay till 10:45?
Come on. You have competition, Jack. I've made commitments.
Where do you have commitment you made? I mean,
11 o'clock.
Where?
Your old station.
I'll send you back in a car.
Well, I've got a driver here, if I need him.
Have you got a driver?
I got my car.
Okay,
you
no
parking
I want. I'll go to the break.
Like say a few words.
Where are you?
All right.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Can I speak to somebody?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Who do you want to talk to?
Michelle, I'll go to the break closest to 10:45. Can I do that?
Go to 11.
The med house is office.
Or I'll go to 11.
Yeah, go to 11. Yeah, go to 11.
I'll go to 11 with Clark.
Yeah, go to 11 with Clark.
Are you up
to get you
are you in the picture, Clark?
Well, sure.
You've been through strikes many a time.
30
no,
seconds.
Not that
here
many.
We go. No. Chris.
Who says we can go till 11?
Yeah, we can go. You can go.
It's called Canadian content.
That's what I know.
Phil Elliott said you can continue. 10.
We've been joined by Clark Davey, the publisher of the Vancouver Sun. Mr. Davey, how long have you been publisher of the Vancouver Sun?
Well, technically and officially, since I suppose midnight Halloween's Eve, but Stu Keat, who was the former publisher, very graciously handed over the reins of the job in the newsroom Tuesday at noon hour.
Tuesday at noon hour. Where are we today? What day is this?
Wait. Thursday, Jack.
Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and you're right up to your eyes in a strike already. Welcome to the West Coast.
It's nice to be here on such a pleasant day.
Listen, I want to finish with Paddy because I wanted to speak to that caller again, but he hung up.
Okay.
This was the caller who said to you that is it not a fact that your exclusions in the editorial in the Guild amount to 50%? And I want to get your reply specifically because you started off saying a handful.
That's right.
What is it?
A handful, by definition. No, we're talking about negotiating. We have opened the subject. We are talking of perhaps up to a couple of dozen.
Up to a couple of dozen, that's 24.
That's right.
That would be 24, let's face it, Paddy, of the key people running departments or close to running departments who are presently influential members of the union, perhaps.
who are members of management, who are having a daily, hourly conflict with their responsibilities in both ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see why they're upset about that, Paddy. The union will look upon that as an attack at the carotid artery.
How upset can you get when what we've said, in effect, is, look, we are prepared, we know you have some emotional problems on this. We are prepared to go to the Labor Relations Board and let them define it simply on the basis of what the new legislation says about who is management and who is an employee.
Trouble with you, Paddy, is that you always sound so reasonable. There must be a kicker somewhere that you're keeping underneath the table. No troubles with the ITU yet?
No, no troubles at all.
No talk of money yet with the ITU?
No, no.
No talk of money yet with the Guild?
No.
Just that one issue of the up to 24 positions, which you'd like to ease out, but at the same time, you're prepared to put that on the laps of the Labour Board to make the definition?
It is conceivable that if we go to the Labour Relations Board, they'll say, take none out. And if that's what they say, we'll live with it.
That's what you say.
Sure.
But everybody...
But Jack, before you go any further, the 24 is not a hard and fast figure. The company's position from day one, and I think a great many members of the Guild in the newsroom, and I still happily have a good many friends in the newsroom, are very much aware that that the company's prepared to be very, very, very flexible on numbers.
Do you agree? Well, obviously you agree with Paddy that the crisis which has caused the pot to boil over is the pressman's attitude and manning.
Well, there's no argument about that. I don't think we are in a crisis situation, even though technically the Guild is on strike against Pacific Press, but I don't feel, and I don't think Paddy feels that we're in a, and I don't think a great many members of the Guild feel that we're in a crisis situation with the Guild over the question of exemptions.
But you're in a crisis situation because you've got a picket line around the place. That's your big crisis, right?
Yes, if you define that as a crisis.
Oh yeah, no picket line, no strike.
That's right.
Now, you will have been asked this before and you will be asked it again. Are you prepared to attempt to operate Pacific Press without the cooperation of union membership?
We have never done that. It is highly unlikely that we would think of it now, but that is a sort of decision that has to be taken on the basis of how things work out in the days and weeks to come.
Clark?
It's not a factor at this point.
It's
not a factor at this point. There's been absolutely no consideration given to it.
It's an interesting point in this connection, though, that at one point the president of the Guild described this whole question as an attempt by management to build a team of scabs that could put out the paper without the unions. Not only put out our papers, but put out other papers across the country.
That's
hashish stuff.
In other words, the 24 people that you might, at the Labour Board said yes, take out of the Guild, wouldn't be enough to put out anything other than a scrap standby paper.
Jack, you know the situation. As soon as there's a picket line around the building of five or six people, we try to go through it and we get everybody in town that's got nothing else to do around there.
And you're
dead.
It's
a very difficult situation.
The Teamsters won't cross the picket line. And you, Clark, of course, it's a matter of fact, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong, that the ITU...
I'll correct you even when you're right, Jack.
The ITU has been striking the old Globe and Mail, your alma mater, for a long number of years.
Since 1964.
1964.
I'm not sure, because I'm not privy to ITU affairs, I'm not sure that the strike still technically is in effect. I have a suspicion that maybe some years ago the ITU wrote it off, just to get it off its books.
Better stop waffling here and get the telephones, because we'll probably find a fair number of interested calls. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Mr. Webster.
Morning.
I'm not very old, but what I've seen so far is the unions.
Are you on the topic of Pacific Press?
Yes, I am.
What's your point?
Okay, what I would like to know is when is Pacific Press Union, as well as all the rest of them, going to stop sticking it in everybody's ear?
Now, you don't make any sense, sir. Sorry about that. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes.
Oh, Mr. Davey.
Yes.
Yes, I'm an employee of Pacific Press, and what I want to find out is about FP Publications, who you work for.
No, I'm an employee of Pacific Press, just as you are, sir.
Okay, quite fine. Okay, but the fact of it is that FP Publications have had a strike in Montreal now for, 5 months? Pressman's Manning has been settled. They came down to Vancouver Manning. Okay. And for that, for coming down to Vancouver Manning, their clause for Manning will not be touched till 1983. They are on a 4-day week, 28 hours a week. Vancouver here, they come down to our Manning. Vancouver Manning is minimal.
Winnipeg, another FP, has signed a contract with Pressman in Winnipeg for better manning than we have here in Vancouver. So why is the gun pointed here?
Okay, I'm going to put that question clearer than you did, perhaps, just to get it clear. That man says that in Montreal, FP has signed a deal with the Pressmen for manning, which brings them down to 4-day, 20-hour week, and it won't be touched again until 28-hour week, and it won't be touched again until 1983. And it seems to me he said that Montreal has just come down to the Vancouver level, right?
That's what he said, but I'm not sure. I don't have any details about the Montreal side.
And he says that an FP in Winnipeg have a better for the Pressmen's Union manning deal than they have here in Vancouver. Is that right?
I don't know the figures in Winnipeg.
I don't know the figures in either case. I'm sorry, I can't comment on that. We have to deal with the situation as it obtains here.
Ah, now, just a minute.
No, not just a minute.
Why not just a minute? All I was going to say to you was that one regards the overall operating company as a company which would attempt to bring equal conditions throughout the entire chain.
Equal conditions at the top or equal conditions at the bottom?
Equal conditions at the union level, especially in feather bedding situations.
You accept that this is a feather bedding situation?
Yes, of course I do.
All right.
I know enough about the industry to know it's feather bedding. I know enough about the union emotion on it that the union wants to preserve its total membership regardless.
I think what we have, Jack, is a situation that I won't say is peculiar to Vancouver, but it's important in Vancouver, is that it's a different competitive situation than it is in Montreal, and certainly far different than it is in Winnipeg. Vancouver's surrounded, as you people know better than a recent arrival like myself, by smaller suburban papers, which have been pressing in upon the market that the province and the Sun have traditionally filled. We'd like to reverse that procedure in a competitive way. We'd like to get into the business of printing, handling, distributing inserts, which I think are an important part of the advertising market, and in fact, they're an important part of the circulation market.
You're not just
and I think that the proposals we've made to the unions are important in maintaining the competitive strength of both the Sun and the province in market conditions that are very specific to Vancouver. And if we can keep the two newspapers strong, we are in fact protecting the jobs of the 1,400 people who work there, including the pressmen and including the mailers and including, goodness grief, the publisher of the province and myself.
Just a minute, you said you'd like to get back into the business in competition with the suburban newspapers. Some of them have been very successful, free circulation ones, you mean. And are you talking about inserts? Are you talking about advertising inserts?
No, I don't want to confuse the two things. We're talking, yes, partly about advertising inserts as part of the business, but we also feel that the suburban newspapers, and not on an insert question specifically, that the suburban newspapers are a growing phenomenon.
And you've got to fight them more efficiently.
We've got to fight them more efficiently and more effectively.
Paddy, do you have to go now?
I have to be away in a couple of minutes, Jack.
Okay, Paddy Sherman, publisher of The Province, thank you. Clark Davey, publisher of The Sun, will you stay?
Oh, yes.
We'll extend the program.
Crazier setup than you head down in Gastown.
Yeah, more fun.
Yeah.
It's growing like we're going to extend the program.